Thank you, Pastor Tom, and thank you, worship team. And I just want to say again that a word of thanks to Pastor Tom for letting me begin a new series this summer. He's heard two summers of series, and he's still letting me do it. I don't know why. Anyway, I'm very grateful for that, and I'm excited to begin this series with you. And with that, let's begin. There are many difficult questions in life. Questions that are hard to communicate, questions that are hard to answer, and questions that are even hard to ask. In a show called Everybody Loves Raymond, the main character Ray is asked one of those difficult questions by his daughter Allie. She asks him, "Daddy, where do babies come from?" And like most of us fathers, as soon as Ray hears this, he panics, and then he gets out of it by faking a sneezing attack and leaving the room. Right? Now, in the scene we're about to watch, Ray has had some time to think about the birds and the bees, and he's prepared now to bring this message to his daughter. But the only problem is, Allie's question was not about the birds and the bees. It was about something much more important and much more difficult to answer. Let's watch what happens and what question is really being asked.
Allie?
Daddy.
Hi. What you doing?
Just playing with my dolls.
Oh, good. Listen, the other day you asked questions about babies and stuff.
When you started sneezing?
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Anyway, I was wondering if you wanted to talk about that now.
Okay.
Good. Okay. Let me try to explain a few things. All right. Okay. Here's what happens. When a man and a woman love each other very much, they get married. And then sometimes they decide to make a baby.
Why are there babies?
Right. Okay, I'm gonna get to that. Okay. What a man and a woman do is...
No, I mean, I know that the man and the woman have to do something, but why are we born? Why has God put us here?
Because that's... What?
If we all go to heaven when we die, then why does God want us here first?
Why does God want us here?
Yeah, why?
Yeah, I heard you. You don't want to talk about sex? You ever hear the word fallopian? Okay, all right. Okay, you really want to know why God wants us here first? That's a good question. You see, God is up in heaven, and, well, honey, it's very crowded up there.
It is?
Yeah. And you don't want to be in heaven if it's crowded, right? I mean, remember when we went to Disney World, how crowded that was? Huh? I mean, it was fun, but it was too crowded, right? So God, he sends us down to Earth for a little while to ease the heavenly congestion.
Okay,
watch this. I don't want you to punch him. Punch him. I'll be back in a minute.
Well, to put it in other words, Allie's question was, what is the meaning of life? What is the meaning of life? It is perhaps the hardest question we will ever have to answer, and that's just the problem we run into. This question is so big, so difficult, that most people do exactly what Ray did. They run away from it. Even if you're a Christian this morning, you must admit that you find it difficult to fully and completely answer that question. I do. Maybe you're like Ray, and maybe you'd just rather explain to your kids about the birds and the bees instead. That seems easier, right? But this question of the meaning of life is also one of the most important we could ever ask or answer. It's a question affecting every area of our lives, individually and as a human race. It is a question every person is yearning to know the truth about, a question we must have an answer to, a question we cannot run from, and a question we must face head on. And it's also a question that God, more than many other questions, wants us to know the answer to. So this morning and this summer, it's the question we'll be asking: what is the meaning of life? What makes my life and our lives significant and purposeful and meaningful? Now, this question is asked and answered all throughout the Bible. And there are many places we could go to find answers to the meaning of life, but no book of the Bible deals with this question as extensively and thoroughly as the book of Ecclesiastes. This morning, we're going to begin a series, a summer-long series on Ecclesiastes called Searching for Significance, covering every book, every chapter of this book. Now, as we get ready, why don't you go ahead and turn there. Ecclesiastes is pretty easy to find. If you just open your Bible to the middle, you'll be in the Psalms, and it's two books later, Proverbs, then Ecclesiastes. So just about right in the middle of your book. And as you're turning there, I do need to warn you. Ecclesiastes is a book that is not often read or preached. And this is perhaps because, well, it's very shrewd. It is brutally honest. And it can get a bit depressing at times. As we will see in a moment, the way the writer of Ecclesiastes answers the question of the meaning of life is by first destroying everything else that cannot be the answer. Therefore, this book is not for those who want to examine the question casually, who are content perhaps with Hallmark cliches, and who are not ready to face the hard realities of life. Because the Bible certainly is. But I promise you that as God uses this book to clear away the darkness of lesser answers to the meaning of life, He will at the same time show us how much brighter the light of His truth and the true meaning of life is for us. But to get there, we must first tear down every banner of this world that seeks to distract us from the true, lasting, and eternal significance God has for us. Thus, we begin our series on Ecclesiastes in chapter 1, and we begin confronted with insignificance. Confronted with insignificance. Let's read chapter 1 together. We're going to read verses 1 through 15. I'll be reading out of the NIV Pew Bible that you have in front of you, and you can follow along in your Bible as well. I'll also have it on the screen for you. Chapter 1. The words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What does man gain from all his labor at which he toils under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they return again. All things are wearisome. More than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. What has been will be again, and what is done will be done again. There's nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, there's something new? It was here already, long ago. It was here before our time. There is no remembrance of men of old, and even those who are yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow. I, the teacher, was king over Israel and Jerusalem. I devoted myself to study and explore by wisdom all that is done under heaven. What a heavy burden God has laid on men. I have seen all the things that are done under the sun. All of them are meaningless, a chasing after the wind. What is twisted cannot be straightened. What is lacking cannot be counted. I told you, Ecclesiastes is not a cheery book, to put that in the least. Now, we'll spend the rest of the morning, the rest of the service, I don't want to scare you, unpacking these 15 verses of chapter 1, which are really the opening to the entire book. And you may have noticed something peculiar about the speaker here in Ecclesiastes that we must first address. He's simply called the teacher. But just exactly who is he and who wrote the book of Ecclesiastes? Who is the teacher? We need to begin here to understand the rest of what's to follow. Now, the word teacher is actually the title given to the book Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes is the Greek for teacher. And in the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament that many Jewish people read out of, this was the word teacher. So they just gave that the title of the book. Now, this person sounds a lot like Solomon, but he's never named. If you look at verse 1 and verse 12 again, it says this, the words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. Verse 12, I, the teacher, was king over Israel in Jerusalem. Now, this is very interesting because Solomon is the only king after David who ruled from Jerusalem over Israel. You see, after Solomon's reign, the kingdom was divided. And it was divided all the way up until the exiles of both Judah and Israel. And so, the last king to ever rule over all of Israel from Jerusalem was Solomon. There was no one else. The north had its own king, Israel, the 10 tribes up here ruling out of Samaria. And the south had its own king ruling out of Jerusalem and the two tribes, Judah and Benjamin. There was no one else after Solomon. Now, the details also of the teacher's life throughout the book, as we'll see in later chapters, are almost identical. They really are identical to Solomon's, and no one else quite fits the description. But why not call him Solomon? Doesn't that seem just a little odd? After all, everywhere else that Solomon, for the most part, has his own teaching, he is named as Solomon. I believe that there is a very important reason for this. It is because the writer of Ecclesiastes is not Solomon, but he is using Solomon as a character to make the point of the book. Let me give you just a few of the reasons why I believe this is so. There are many, but we have time just for a few. First of all, the teacher is spoken of by the writer in the third person. We see this in verse 1 and verses 9 and 10. It says, the words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. He doesn't say these are my words necessarily. Verse 9 and 10, not only was the, and this is chapter 12, sorry, 9 and 10. Not only was the teacher wise, but also he imparted knowledge to the people. He pondered and searched out and set in order many proverbs. The teacher searched to find just the right words, and what he wrote was upright and true. So he's spoken of in the third person. And secondly, Solomon ended his life as an idol worshiper and an apostate and would not have written a book giving glory to Yahweh, which the writer of Ecclesiastes ends up doing. We see this in 1 Kings 11 at the end of Solomon's life. It says this, Solomon had 700 wives of royal birth and 300 concubines, and his wives led him astray. As Solomon grew old, his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not fully devoted to the Lord his God, as the heart of David his father had been. He followed Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and Molech, the detestable god of the Ammonites. So Solomon did evil in the eyes of the Lord. He did not follow the Lord completely, as David his father had done. See, Solomon was not about to write a book for the Lord at the end of his life. So it seems to me that the writer and the character Solomon are two different people. And this means, I think, that the writer uses Solomon as a character in his book to make a point. But the writer is the one making the main point, not the teacher. Now, the teacher, therefore, is being used as a kind of foil. The writer is the one who will drive home the main point and does so in chapter 12. And in this sense, the book is a bit like a novel telling the teachings of a man who had it all and became overwhelmed with the meaninglessness of life apart from God. Now, this is further proved when the teacher says things that are clearly hostile to God and short-sighted about meaning in life. Thus, as we read the teacher in Ecclesiastes, I think we need to look at him the same way we do any of Job's three friends in the book of Job. Now, most all of you know that the three friends of Job, though they are real, were wrong. This doesn't mean that everything they said was wrong, but they at least were short-sighted and didn't understand the full picture of Job's situation. Yet everything that they said and taught is recorded in Job. Some of it is true, some of it is misdirected. And the same is true of the teacher here. Or let me put it this way. The teacher in Ecclesiastes is like a bitter old man. He's a man looking back on his life who has become cynical and critical of the world, right? Meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless. And though he is pessimistic, a bit crotchety, and likes to rant, he has a vantage point on life that we all really need to hear and need to deal with. He has the wisdom that is only gained by looking back on one's life after living it, a wisdom that has seen what works and what doesn't. He cannot be fooled with the false promises the world has to offer. He is anything but naive. But he's also a bit jaded and brutally honest. Yeah, it took you a minute there, huh? And just as we can only take a senile old man's words with a grain of salt, so we're meant to do the same with the teacher in Ecclesiastes. He is meant to shock us. He is meant to challenge us. And he's meant to force us to look seriously at the true meaning of life by seeing clearly what it cannot be. So let's get on with the message, with his message. And we begin with the meaninglessness of life. The meaninglessness of life. This is the main point of this introductory teaching in verses 2 to 15, and I believe it naturally breaks up into five different parts which explain why, according to the teacher, life is meaningless. So let's look at those five points. First, the world is full of ceaseless but meaningless activity. Ceaseless but meaningless activity. Let's look again at verses 3 through 7. What does man gain from all his labor at which he toils under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they return again. Notice this phrase, under the sun. This phrase is repeated by the teacher throughout the book, giving us a hint that he is limiting his perspective to life on earth without hope of an afterlife. Life within the walls of this lifetime and this lifetime alone. So that's key for the rest of the book. And this is not because he doesn't believe in God. He clearly mentions God several times throughout the book. And even though much of what he says is very much like what atheists say today, he in fact is a man who has become jaded not just with life, but a man who's become jaded with God. We see this in verse 13 and many other verses that we'll see in the future. What a heavy burden God has laid on men. He really has no hope of an afterlife because he thinks God would never give him such a thing. There is no hope for it. So what does he see under the sun? Ceaseless but meaningless activity. People come and go in life without making a significant change to what happens on the earth. Everything that happens on the earth is just an endless cycle of movement without any real lasting change. The sun rises just to set again. The wind blows through just to return again. And all the water in the sea and the rivers is just reshuffling itself. No meaningful lasting change happens within this lifetime. This is true of so much of what we do, isn't it? Make our beds so that we can get them messy again. Do our dishes so that we can get to make them dirty again. We exercise and diet so that later we can break our diet. Every day, the world is so busy with movement, with activity, and yet every day this activity ends only to begin again the next day. Back and forth to work, to home, to school, to church, to after school, over and over and over again. To the teacher, life is like a frantic couple trying to find their way through a busy city, driving as fast as they can and never realizing that all the time they've been driving in circles. All kinds of busyness, all kinds of movement, all kinds of things that seem like change, but are really just more of the same on an endless loop. So the first thing we see in this passage is ceaseless but meaningless activity. What else is meaningless about life within this world? The lack of contentment. Lack of contentment. Verse 8. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. The world is always looking and listening for something new, something fun, something exciting, something to fill another day, another TV show, another book, another vacation, another lesson, another sermon, and on and on and on. The search never stops within this lifetime. Guys, have you ever watched a football game, undoubtedly the Bears, and thought to yourself, well, that was really a great game. Honey, I never need to watch another football game in my life. Anyone? Yeah? No? Don't think so. Women, and please don't beat me up. I've got to be fair here. Women, you ever bought a new pair of shoes or a purse or dress and thought, wow, this is great. Honey, I'm never going to buy another pair of shoes or purse or dress again. I don't think so. Please don't throw any of that at me. We're never content with the things of this world, and never will be. Never. Lack of contentment. What else is meaningless in this world? The same things keep repeating, nothing is new. The same things keep repeating, nothing is new. Verse 9 and 10. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There's nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, there's something new? It was here already, long ago. It was here before our time. This is similar to the first point about ceaseless but meaningless activity, except that it focuses on nothing in life really ever being new. Nothing. Malcolm Muggeridge once said that all news is old news happening to new people. That's true. And lest we become enamored with the 20th century and all the inventions and industry that we have created, there's a good point made by David Finkbeiner in the Moody Bible Commentary about this, and he says this: the teacher is not denying the possibility of human invention, but is analyzing the fundamental human condition. Much like the well-known proverb, the more things change, the more they stay the same. So one who hopes to find something new and satisfying under the sun that fundamentally alters the human condition is on a fool's errand. For all of our work and progress in technology and medicine, what has really changed about the basic desires, problems, and needs of the human race and of every person's life? We may live longer, and we certainly do. We may have more things to play with, and we may enjoy better health and comfort throughout our lifetime. But are we really doing much that is different from humanity through history? The teacher says to us, your life is nothing new. Nothing new. You go to school, you get a job, you get married, you have kids, you raise kids, you retire, you have grandkids, and you pass on. For the next generation, to go to school, to get a job, to get married, to have kids, to pass on. The same things keep repeating, nothing is new. What else is meaningless about life? Everyone will be forgotten. Everyone will be forgotten. Verse 11. There is no remembrance of men of old, and even those who are yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow. Despite all we keep hearing in movies and in sports about passing on a legacy, about being remembered through the annals of history, let's put this to a very simple test. Raise your hand if you know by name your great-grandparents. Go ahead, raise your hand. There should be a few, right? The majority of you. Keep your hand raised. Keep it raised. Now, keep your hand raised if you've met your great-grandparents. Good. We got still some. Keep your hand raised if you know the names of your great-great-grandparents. Okay, now just a couple. Some of you should know this. Some of you do the genealogy trees. That's good. Now, keep your hand raised if you know a generation beyond that. Okay, we've got one, two, three, couple people. Here's a simple point. Despite all we hear about living on and our legacies, most of us hardly, if at all, know just a couple generations ago of our own families. And those of us who do, we may know their names, but we've never met them. We may talk about them and know their history, but we only do so a handful of times in our lifetime, if at all. And eventually, they will be forgotten, and you will be forgotten. Not even a memory. And we're just talking about, with what the test we just did, the mid to late 1800s. It's not that long ago. So let's review. Why is there meaninglessness in life within this lifetime? Well, there's just ceaseless but meaningless activity. There's a lack of contentment, total lack. The same things keep repeating, nothing is new, and everyone will be forgotten. In sum, the writer of Ecclesiastes says, no problem is ever resolved, and no end is in sight for anything. No problem is ever resolved, and no end is in sight for anything. Let's read verses 12 to 15 again. I, the teacher, was king over Israel and Jerusalem. I devoted myself to study and to explore by wisdom all that is done under heaven. What a heavy burden God has laid on men. I've seen all the things that are done under the sun. All of them are meaningless, a chasing after the wind. What is twisted cannot be straightened. What is lacking cannot be counted. This last phrase here sums the point up well. What is twisted cannot be straightened. In other words, nothing is ever finally and meaningfully resolved. Old problems just keep repeating throughout time, and no one will be able to overcome them. What is lacking cannot be counted. Another way to translate this, a better way, I think, is what is lacking cannot be supplied. What is left undone will never be done. There are limitations on mankind that he or she will never be able to overcome, and there's no end in sight for anything that is lacking in the world and in us within this time frame, within this lifetime. Now, though this teacher is an old crotchety man who's very pessimistic and has a very jaded outlook on life, this is all true. Within the confines of this world, absent of an afterlife, this is all absolutely, totally true. And if this world is all there is, then we can and must say with the teacher, meaningless, meaningless, all is meaningless. Now, Ecclesiastes is not the only place we find this reality understood. It is the truth of the world of unbelievers. It's a truth, really, for all atheists who reject God and an afterlife and the supernatural world, but only some are really willing to admit it. In a movie called Expelled, No Intelligence Allowed, there is a interview that's given of an atheist, an evolutionary atheist, who admits this fact about his life. I'm going to watch this now.
No gods, no life after death, no ultimate foundation for ethics, no ultimate meaning in life, and no human free will are all deeply connected to an evolutionary perspective. You're here today and you're gone tomorrow, and that's all there is to it.
Dr. Will Provine, professor of the history of biology at Cornell University, gave us another disturbing glimpse into where Darwinism can lead.
Oh, I was a Christian, but I never heard anything about evolution because it was illegal to teach it in Tennessee.
Dr. Provine's first biology professor changed all that.
He started talking about evolution as if it had no design in it whatsoever. And I came up to him and I said, "You've left out the most important part." And he said, "If you feel the same way at the end of one quarter, I want you to stand up in front of the students in this class and tell them this deep lack in evolution." And I read that book so carefully, and I could find no sign of there being any design whatsoever in evolution. And I immediately began to doubt the existence of the deity. But it starts by giving up an active deity, then it gives up the hope that there's any life after death. When you give those two up, the rest of it follows fairly easily. You give up the hope that there's an imminent morality. And finally, there's no human free will. If you believe in evolution, you can't hope for there being any free will. There's no hope whatsoever of there being any deep meaning in human life. We live, we die, and we're gone. We're absolutely gone when we die.
It's sad, isn't it? But it's true. If this is all there is, life is meaningless. Ravi Zacharias has this quote in a book called The End of Reason about evolutionary atheism, and he says this: "If life is random, then the inescapable consequence, first and foremost, is that there can be no ultimate meaning and purpose to existence. This consequence is the existential Achilles heel of atheistic belief. As individuals and collectively as cultures, we humans long for meaning. But if life is random, we have climbed the evolutionary ladder only to find nothing at the top." Now, we could leave the message here. It is where chapter 1 ends. But something in you right now is wanting more. Something in you is not satisfied with this reality, is yearning for meaning, for significance. Even if you're an atheist this morning, you're not satisfied with this answer, though it's true. You desire more than this life has to give you. What's happening is your soul knows that it was meant for something more, for something beyond this world. And you're right, there is more. For our last point, we're going to a place in the New Testament where the same term meaninglessness is mentioned and an answer is given. Turn with me to Romans 8, 18 to 21 to see meaning restored in eternal life. Meaning restored in eternal life. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed, for the creation was subjected to frustration, to meaninglessness, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. This word frustration is the word used in the Septuagint, Greek translation of the Old Testament, for meaningless. The meaninglessness of the world is not without end. There is a glory that's far surpassing any meaninglessness in this lifetime, a glory whereby those who trust in Christ will be lifted from death in the resurrection and experience an eternally meaningful life with God, and one that begins today. The real meaninglessness in this world is what the gospel saves us from, and in place of it, Jesus Christ gives us eternal significance. A significance which gives value to what seems meaninglessness even in this lifetime. For God is watching, and God will straighten what has been twisted. God will fill what cannot be supplied by us. You need God's eternal life today. Without it, we must admit that our lives are meaningless. And I don't think anyone in here is satisfied with that. I'm going to pray a prayer in just a minute. And if you have never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior to give you true, real meaning, I'd like you to pray that prayer with me. But I'd also like you to continue this series with us as we explore more fully what this meaning really is and what it must be. Pray with me. Father God, we admit as Christians even in this room that this world is not the way it's meant to be. You've told us that this world is in frustration, that there are things that are meaningless if all we can see is what's happening around us. But Lord, you call us to so much more. You call us to look beyond this world. You call us to look through the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who gives us real hope that things will be restored, that you will draw us to yourself, and that we will have eternal life, a life we know deep in our hearts we were meant for. Lord Jesus, if there's anyone here this morning that doesn't know this meaning, I pray that you would speak to their hearts. And if they are ready, they would pray this prayer with me right now. That, Lord Jesus, I admit my life is meaningless without you. My meaning and significance and purpose is all in you. And I ask that you'd forgive me for my sins and that you would restore the meaning that I have destroyed in my own life. And that sin is destroyed in our world, and that you would walk with me today and forever in true meaning and in true relationship with the God who created me and who loves me. In Jesus' name, we all pray. Amen. My Savior loves me.